As we all come back and find our seats, I'm actually going to share with you a story of my unintentional mishap. Some of you know my wife, Lisa, and when it was the day that I asked her to marry me, I'm trying to think of all the things that happened. So, you know, I had dinner planned. It was her birthday weekend. I had a photographer waiting in the bushes, and the day was planned. Oh, hey, cool. the day was planned to the minute. And so what I did was I opened up Open Table. Some of you know the restaurant Centro downtown, right? It's amazing. Half price pizza on Mondays. You should go. So I pull up Open Table on the app. I make my reservation for Centro. But what I didn't realize is that there is a Centro in on the East Coast, like in Maine or New Hampshire or something. And so we show up, you know, I've got everything planned. And for those of you that have asked someone to marry you, you know the stress, and I have the ring and I have all the things. And we get to Centro and I say, hey, I have a reservation for two. And they're like, no, you don't. And I was like, yes, I do. What are you talking about? Like, the photographer is waiting in the bushes. Like, we don't have time for this. We don't have time. And so so I pull up my app. You know, I'm like, I'm going to show you that I have this reservation. Pull it up, and it was for Centro in New Hampshire. So my unintentionality in that moment cost us a lot of time. But thankfully, she still said yes. The end of the story is she still said yes. And I got really, really lucky with that one. But I'm so thankful to be here, up here this morning. I want you to know that I feel like the peasant among kings when Kyle asked me to speak to you all. The guys up here are legends to me and in my mind, and I'm really, really excited and thankful to be able to share with you this morning. And we've heard great things so far last night and this morning, and I really pray and hope that you have been encouraged, and I hope that there's some wind in your sails after what you hear, even this morning, because my prayer is not only to challenge you, but it's to give you hope. It's to encourage you. And this idea of intentionality, I'm sorry, it's taken on a whole new meaning for me in the last 2 weeks, because the truth is that you and I, we're not promised tomorrow, right? My friends and my family, they're not promised tomorrow. This heart will stop beating. This mind, it will misfire, and when it does, it's done. All of it. And unfortunately with me, I don't get the 15-year warranty that we love on our appliances, right? Like, especially me, because I have to take a nap after I change a light bulb. I don't have the 15-year warranty, and so the time is closer than we know. So intentionality matters. Why? Because eternity matters. And that leads me to start with a question. You know, men, as Saylorville men, as men of the 21st century, we have so much represented in this room even. You know, we've got the college kid. We've got the single guy. We've got the boyfriend. Maybe you're the one that's engaged. Maybe you're a husband, your dad, you're divorced, you're retired. I don't know. But the question is, what has our affection? What has your affection here sitting this morning? We give our affections and our attention to so many different things. And if we start by asking ourselves simply, what has our affections? We quickly get to a working definition, hopefully practical, of what we're going to be talking about here this morning, which is worship. What is worship, and how do we define something so deep and meaningful as it? If I'm honest, it's a bit difficult for me to put a solid definition to worship, because we know it, right? It's that deep reverence for someone or something. It's adoration. It's that deep love. It's simply put, it's what we give our affection, right? But you know what's not so hard about worship to define is that we can look at each other, and I can look at you, and I can look at your life, and I can tell you could tell me what I worship, right? Just by the way we live. And how can we do that? How can I do that? Because it's easy to see that the focus and the object of our attention starts to change the way we live. Our worship core value at Saylorville Church says, surrender the moment, which makes me ask the question, well then what are we surrendering to? And this talk is a little bit unconventional in the ways that we think of worship. And that's my goal, is to kind of bump our view out of it's not just Paul up here with his guitar singing beautifully. It's so much more than that. And my goal is simple, one that God has been refining even in my own heart in the last few days, and that is to realign our hearts and our minds, right? Turn us again, O God, to yourself, to realign our attention and aspire our hearts, my heart, to run after God and Him only in His glory. My, oh my, how we need to realign. And we need to look at that one thing, God and His glory, and forsake all other glories. The reason is this, right? Because we become, you've heard it before, right? We become what we behold. Again, it's worship. What we give our affection, what we give our attention. So there's a lot at stake here. Another way that I have thought about it in my mind, and maybe you can write this down, the objects of our affection shape our becoming. The objects of our affection shape our becoming. Intentional worship requires our full attention, our focus, and our affection. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, and we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. So how do we worship? How do we change? How do we actually look more like Jesus? How do we even pursue this idea of intentionality? It can feel impossible, if I'm honest. The answer is one thing. We fix our eyes and hold our affection on the glory of God. It's the only way. Throw out any self-help. If you and I can behold the glory of God each and every moment of each and every day, we will start to see our minds change from one degree of glory to the other. We will start to think a little bit more like He thinks. We see things the way He sees them, and we start to love what He loves, and we hate what He hates. And we start to actually look like Him. Quickly, I'm going to pray for that. God, would you just give us focus and attention to be able to fix our eyes on you this morning as we pursue this idea of worship? God, would there even be one man in this room to be so bold enough to say, God, would you speak directly to me here in this room this morning? Would you give me something that I can work on and to change to look more like yourself, God? Because when we see your glory, we can't walk away the same. And so I pray that you would teach us from your word. God, give us wisdom. God, get rid of anything that is not from you in this room. And would you use me in my frailty? And it's in your son's name I pray. Amen. So open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 22. We're going old school. We're going back to the Old Testament. Going back to the beginning. And I'd like to ask the question here this morning, what does intentional worship require of us? Genesis 22, briefly, I'd like to look at this amazing account of a story that I love. It's a testing of faith that produces worship. You have Abraham, right, who has a promise from God that through him and his family, all the nations of the earth will find God's blessing. Abraham has a wife. Her name is Sarah. Finally, right, they're old people. In their old age, they have a son named Isaac. And this kid is special. He is the fulfillment of a promise. And we come to chapter 22 in the story of Genesis, and God speaks directly to Abraham and asks him to take his son, right, his only son, sacrifice him, and it becomes a true test of faith. But not only that, it becomes a true test of worship for the life of Abraham. And from this, I find what I would say for my own life, three intentional ways to become a deeper, more fervent worshiper. And the first is this, we must surrender to God, right? Surrender to God. It starts in verse 1. Sometime later, God tested Abraham's faith. Abraham, God called. Yes, he replied. here I am. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains, which I will show you." So here we have Abraham hearing the voice of God, and he responds with what? "Here I am." God's mission is worth our lives. Think about it. Abraham had no idea what the Lord was going to say next. But he starts and he responds with surrender. Even before he knew what the Lord wanted him to do. That's the definition of surrender, right? When God says it, we do it. He and his ways are always better. His ways are always higher. And intentional worship will take an intentional heart posture. Each and every morning, we have to wake up. I want you to wake up, and I want you to say, "God, here I am." Imagine for a second that you're Nick Long. Again, he should be here. And do you think he knows what God is asking of him right now? Or is his surrender in the unknown his truest act of worship? God says trials will come. We know that, right? God's word tells us that. God says our life here on earth is a vapor. We know that. But intentional worship requires us to believe and live out true surrender, that Nick could come to a place, and I pray that he does, each and every moment he says, "God, you do what you want with my life. I want worship like that in my life." Okay, but does God still speak to us, right? Like Abraham heard from God. Yeah, God has spoken to us. We've heard his voice. He's given us his word. He's given us the Holy Spirit. We have direct access to the very words of God, and we know what he's asking of us. He's shown us the way, and it's right here. Psalm 119:9, one of my favorite verses. "How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to this." So if we're going to surrender to anything, surrender to this each and every morning. How can we keep his word if we don't open it? When is the last time that you've heard from the Lord through his word? And are you surrendered to it? I'm convinced that surrender is our first and only response for worship. If we don't start there, none of the rest matters. We throw up our hands when we sing. Why do we throw up our hands in worship? What does it picture? It's the best picture of surrender, right? It's like the little kid coming to his dad saying, "I need you." And some of you in this room, you need to surrender your life to Jesus for the first time. Salvation is found in no other name but Jesus. And it may be what he's speaking to you right now. You think you've surrendered, but you haven't. If I were to look at your life, it's just that. It's your life. It's your agenda. There's no evidence of surrender to a greater purpose anywhere in your life. And you, your step this morning is to believe in the transformative work of the gospel. We take our true cue from Jesus, right? He is the first to surrender, the ultimate surrender, to the Father's will. He died for you and for me so that we could have new life with him if we accept that gift of salvation, that free gift. He poured out his life to give us new life. We all need to say every morning, "God, here I am. God, do what you want with me and my life, because I know that you are only good. I know that you are just. I know that you are kind. I know you're faithful." Intentional worship is going to involve surrender. Second, an intentional way to deepen worship is we must follow in obedience. Let's pick it up in the story. Follow in obedience, starting in verse 3. "So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac, and he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and he saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, 'Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there, catch this, and worship, and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering, laid it on Isaac, his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father!" And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. Intentional worship is going to require obedience in our life. And I've come to realize in my own heart that obedience, it's just not the sexy thing. Obedience has turned into that old school vibe a little bit, right? In our hearts. It's dusty. It's musty. But listen, maybe the only thing I'm here to remind you of this morning is that men, as Saylorville men, as men of God, it's what we should be known for. Obedience could be some of our truest acts of worship. Abraham, he clearly trusted the plan. He had faith. He was focused on God's glory, and he knew that God would provide. Did he understand why he was making him do what he was doing? Probably not. Was it what he wanted? No. I mean, it was crazy. God promised that through Abraham's children, and in this case, singular child, he would show his glory to the nations. In my mind, the kid kind of has to be alive to do that. But Abraham, he had faith. And worship requires faith that God is going to come through on his promise every time. He always has and he always will. So we can worship that. So you and I, we need to not just open this thing and be men of it, but we need to be people who live by it and obey it. There's a difference. I can open it and go away empty and choose to live my own life. But that man's deceived. But to actually be changed by the words of God. And listen, I know that it is a struggle to live a life of worship. I struggle. I have to be honest. I struggle to live a life of worship. I work with young adults. Oh my goodness. They struggle to live a life of worship. And I work and I see men. We struggle to worship. And we wonder why. And I'm here to just suggest this morning that maybe it's because we're just so unwilling to obey. I live often in a pattern of choosing my flesh over the spirit. I see young adults every day choose their flesh over their spirit. I see men every day choose their flesh over their spirit. Intentional worship involves obedience. So I have to ask you, what's your next step of obedience here this morning, right? Where are you going to leave this weekend and what are you going to choose to do? Because when you choose the spirit over the flesh, that's worship. When you choose to be content with where God has you, that's worship. When you choose to pick up your Bible, read it, and be changed by it, that's worship. When you choose to love your wife, if you have one, and your kids, if you have them, that's worship. When you love your neighbor like yourself, that's worship. So what's your next step of obedience? What's God bringing to mind right now that you need to just obey in? The third and final way to deepen worship intentionally is to expect sacrifice. Expect sacrifice. Let's pick it up. Genesis 22, verse 9. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there, and he laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Wow. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Again, here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his thorns, and Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. It was the testing of Abraham's faith that called him to sacrifice the thing he loved most, which would lead him up a mountain to a place of intentional worship. Was it about the outcome? Was it even about the ram that was stuck behind him, right? Or was it more about Abraham's obedience in the midst of sacrifice? It was all about it. It was all about Abraham's faith that led him there to worship, even in sacrifice, even in the thing that he loved most. He was willing to lay it on the altar. And so we ask the question, and I ask the question in my own heart, what is God calling us to sacrifice here this morning? What is God calling you to sacrifice so that you can truly worship him? Because, listen, if you're holding something back, we're not worshiping. We are. We're just worshiping ourselves. We're worshiping our pride. Isaac, he was the fruit of a promise, but get this, he wasn't the prize. God's glory was the prize. Jesus, the coming Messiah, hope for the nations, was the prize. So see, it's that question again. It's Abraham's affection. What held Abraham's affection in that moment? It was set on one thing. And here's the truth. I felt this last 2 weeks more than ever, that worship, I hope I don't bust your bubble here, but worship is work. And maybe we just need to hear that this morning and get our minds around that it's not something that we like conjure up. It's not something that we just sing. It's not only a feeling. It's not just a loud noise of praise, but pure and simple, it's sacrifice. It's putting our lives on the altar each and every day. It's a lifestyle of worship. And as men, I've come to realize that we treasure our pride more than anything, which leads us to treasure performance, often more than anything. And it's that achievement, right, that really gets us going. You translate it into your own situation, but you want to talk about sexy? It's that relationship that I want, that I know I'm going to go after and I'm going to get it. It's performance in your job. It's performance in your marriage, in your friendships, in sex, in finances. The list goes on and on and on and on. But we are rarely, in all of those things, we're unwilling to sacrifice our performance for fear of being exposed as what? We said it last night. Weak. So maybe the purest and simplest form of worship here this morning would be for you to lay your pride on the altar and say, God, I'm weak. Because we are. It's only our pride keeping us from that. So I want to leave you with this. The questions. What has your affection? Is it God and is it his glory? How's your obedience? What's your next step of obedience? And what is God calling you to sacrifice here this morning to be more intentional? Our greatest worship is often just our obedience. Our greatest worship is our sacrifice. Let's pray. God, we're so thankful to be here as men. We're moved by your word. We're moved by these stories of men of great faith that were moved to such a place of worship. And I pray, God, that you would start a fire in this group here in this room this morning, God, that one person would choose surrender today, that one person would choose obedience, and the next would choose surrender, God, and that you would be pleased with the worship that comes from our lives each and every moment. We cannot do it on our own, God. We pray for Holy Spirit power. Keep us close to your word, God. Give us instruction through it. And may we be men of worship. May you just wreck our lives, because we know tomorrow's not guaranteed. And may we live intentionally today. God, we're thankful for your Son and his death and his resurrection. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.